Hello, I'm Henry Fulmer, director of the South Carolina Library at the University of South Carolina, which is home to the SIMS initiatives. We are a digital humanities project of the university libraries, funded in part with a generous grant from the Watson Brown Foundation. In celebration of Halloween and to promote our site, we are reading one of SIMS's ghost stories throughout the month of October. This story is called Grayling, or Murder Will Out, and it's part of the author's short story collection, The Wigwam and the Cabin. At this point in the story, the travelers who shared the Grayling camp have just parted company with the family, first McNabb and then Major Spencer. Before he left, the latter reiterated his distrust of the Scotchman. Here now is part 9 of William Gilmore Simms's Grayling, or Murder Will Out. The repast being over, all parties set forward. But Spencer, after keeping along with them for a mile, took his leave also. The slow wagon pace at which the family traveled did not suit the high-spirited cavalier, and it was necessary, as he assured them, that he should reach the city in 2 nights more. They parted with many regrets, as truly felt as they were warmly expressed. And James Grayling never felt the tedium of wagon traveling to be so severe as throughout the whole of that day when he separated from his favorite captain. But he too was stout-hearted a lad to make any complaint, and his dissatisfaction only showed itself in his unwanted silence and an over-anxiety which his steed seemed to feel in common with himself to go rapidly ahead. Thus the day passed, and the wayfarers at its close had made a progress of some 20 miles from sun to sun. The same precautions marked their encampment this night as the last, and they rose in better spirits with the next morning, the dawn of which was very bright and pleasant and encouraging. A similar journey of 20 miles brought them to the place of bivouac as the sun went down, and they prepared as usual for their securities and supper. They found themselves on the edge of a very dense forest of pines and scrubby oaks, a portion of which was swallowed up in a deep bay, so called in the dialect of the country, a swamp bottom, the growth of which consisted of mingled cypresses and bay trees with tupelo, gum, and dense thickets of low-stunted shrubbery, cane grass, and dwarf willows, which filled up every interval between the trees and to the eye most effectually barred out every human intruder. This bay was chosen as the background for the camping party. Their wagon was wheeled into an area on a gently rising ground in front, under a pleasant shade of oaks and hickories, with a lonely pine rising loftily in occasional spots among them. Here the horses were taken out, and James Grayling prepared to kindle up a fire. But looking for his axe, it was unaccountably missing, and after a fruitless search of half an hour, the party came to the conclusion that it had been left on the spot where they had slept last night. This was a disaster, and while they meditated in what manner to repair it, a Negro boy appeared in sight, passing along the road at their feet and driving before him a small herd of cattle. From him they learned that they were only a mile or two from a farmstead where an axe might be borrowed, and James, sleeping on his horse, rode forward in the hope to obtain one. He found no difficulty in his quest, and having obtained it from the farmer, who also was a tavern keeper, he casually asked if Major Spencer had not stayed with him the night before. He was somewhat surprised when he was told that he had not. "There was one man who stayed with me last night," said the farmer, "but he didn't call himself a major and didn't much look like one. He rode a fine sorrel horse, tall, bright color, with white forefoot, didn't he?" asked James. "No, he didn't. He rode a powerful black, coal black, and not a bit of white about him." "That was the Scotchman, but I wonder the major didn't stop with you. He must have rode on. Isn't there another house near you below? Not one. There's near a house either above or below for a matter of 15 miles. I'm the only man in all that distance that's living on this road, and I don't think your friend could have gone below as I would have seen him pass. I've been all day out there in that field before your eyes, clearing up the brush. This has been part 9 of William Gilmore Sims's Grayling or Murder Will Out. I hope you will tune in next time for another section of this exciting tale. If you would like to read the full text of this story or any of the many other works we have available, we invite you to visit the Sims Initiative's website at sims.library.sc.edu. Until then, happy Halloween.